Hello, I am Dr. Mahmoud Roussasi, Professor of Orthopedic Surgery and Traumatology, Chief of Limb Lengthening and Reconstruction and Pediatric Orthopedics from Tanta University Faculty of Medicine from Tanta, Egypt. I will present the case scenarios about complex foot and ankle deformities corrected by talectomy and supramedullary osteotomy. Case 1. The case of rigid foot deformity due to arthrogryposis in an 8-year-old boy who has arthrogryposis and multiple joint stiffness in the form of bilateral hip dislocation, stiff knees. He had a previous attempt to correct the foot by Elazar frame, which failed. The idea of talectomy is to provide acute and relatively safe correction of the severe recurrent deformity in rigid foot deformities due to arthrogryposis. The procedure is performed through an anterolateral approach or lear approach to the subtalar joint and the talus. In children, the complete excision of the talus is necessary because any residual parts of the talus will regrow and account for recurrence of the deformity. After complete excision of the talus, the foot is deformity is acutely corrected in a manner like closing wedge osteotomy. The foot position is maintained under the tibia by transcalcanean wires, and the fixation is completed by a simplified Elazar frame. Please notice here the direction of insertion of the wires in the leg and in the metatarsus, and transcalcanean wires are held in the foot ring. The Elazar frame will allow fine tuning of the deformity in the post-operative time follow-up if there is residual under-correction. This is another view of the fixation. The frame is maintained about 8 weeks until complete healing of the soft tissue, and will is removed and replaced by a walking cast for another 6 to 8 weeks, and then the rigid plastic splint is used for at least 20 years to prevent recurrence of the deformity. This is a preoperative clinical photo, and this is a follow-up. The aim of treatment of such cases is a plantigrade, stable, painless foot, and is showable foot, like in this case. And this is 3 years of follow-up, and the deformity correction is still maintained. The second case is a case of clubfoot, rigid clubfoot deformity due to arthrogryposis in a 12-year-old girl who has arthrogryposis with rigid foot deformity, previously had several surgeries to correct the deformity. We can notice here the posteromedial approach bilaterally to correct the deformity. She had unstable gait due to the narrow base here because weight bearing is only on the head of the fifth metatarsus. As a consequence, she developed a penetrating ulcer with infection and osteomyelitis of the fifth metatarsus on both feet. On the right side, it was resistant and treated by excision by another surgeon, excision of the fifth metatarsus. This X-ray saw the severity of the deformity. We treated her by talectomy through the Ollier approach and simplified external fixator fixation of the foot. We can notice here a stable, plantigrade, painless, and showable foot with minimal surgical interference. There is a reasonable range of motion at the pseudo joint between the calcaneus and the talus, plantar flexion and dorsiflexion. There's a preoperative picture and the follow-up. And this is 5 years of follow-up after talectomy of the same patient, showing nice correction of the deformity. The third case is a post-traumatic distal tibial growth plate injury with severe valgus and recurvatum deformity of the ankle joint, arthritic and stiff ankle joint, 2 scarred soft tissue, and leg length discrepancy of 4 centimeters. This is a 4-year-old child who had open fracture of the distal tibia and degloved skin, treated by serial debridements and split thickness skin graft. We notice here the tough scar here adherent to the distal tibia, the calcaneus deformity and recurvatum. We notice here in the X-ray destruction of the distal tibial physis, accounting for the severe valgus deformity of the distal tibia and the leg length discrepancy of 4 cm. The preoperative planning showed the cora at the level of the ankle joint, so we planned the correction through a supramedial osteotomy for correction of the deformity gradually and the leg lengthening of 5 cm. Two scarred soft tissues. Very important is that the frame should match the deformity of the leg. The proximal ring is perpendicular to the mechanical axis of the proximal tibia. The distal ring is parallel to the ankle joint line. The hinge on the convex side on the bisector line at the level of the cora and on the convex side to allow opening wedge osteotomy and lengthening of the tibia. We should remember the rule of 4 fingers to know the direction of insertion of the olive wires. The olive wires are inserted near the deformity on the convex side and far from the deformity on the concave side to increase the efficiency of correction and enhance the stability of the construct. Please notice here the placement of the olive wires on the concave side far from the deformity and on the convex side near to the deformity. The osteotomy is as close to the deformity as possible to minimize the amount of the translation. Osteotomy rule 2. The frame is applied to match the deformity. So at the end of the correction, the distal ring should be parallel to the proximal ring to ensure complete correction of the deformity. This another view to show the foot ring. The ring is converted into an oval shape to accommodate the foot. Please notice here the direction of the insertion of the calcanean wires to increase the stability of the construct and the metatarsal wires here shown in this graph. It's better to perform the wire tensioning on a closed construct according to Elizarov. The most stable construct is a closed one, so it's better to have a closed ring. After deformity correction and lengthening, the two rings are parallel to each other. After completion of correction and lengthening of about 5 cm, we notice here the translation of the distal segment according to osteotomy rule 2 because the cora is far from the osteotomy site. The follow-up showing the plantigrade foot and over-lengthened tibia because this child, the tibia will regrow and develop another shortening and will need another lengthening operation. So we intentionally over-lengthened the tibia to postpone the next surgery. This follow-up X-ray shows consolidation of the regenerate, lengthening regenerate, and parallel joint lines and restoration of the mechanical axis, and the follow-up clinical and X-rays. The last case is a post-traumatic distal tibial growth plate injury showing severe ankle and hind foot valgus deformity in an 11-year-old girl who had open fracture of the distal tibia treated by serial debridements. We can notice here the severe valgus deformity and the mechanical disadvantage of the gastrocnemius due to the deviation of the tendoachilles. This X-ray shows the deficiency, marked deficiency of the lateral malleus due to growth arrest of the distal fibular physis and the partial growth arrest of the distal tibia and the progressive valgus deformity, the Taylor tilt and the Taylor shift. A preoperative scanogram showed over-lengthening of the affected side about 2 cm, which would allow acute correction by a closing wedge osteotomy. The preoperative planning, the mechanical axis of the proximal tibia, the joint orientation line of the ankle, mechanical axis of the distal segment, the cora is located in the supramalleolar area. Intraoperatively, it's very important is the insertion of the reference pins. The distal reference pin is parallel to the ankle joint line, the proximal reference pin is perpendicular to the mechanical axis of the proximal segment, and then the external fixture is mounted to the reference pins, and the fixation is completed. Please notice here the axis of the hinges here is perpendicular to the plane of maximum deformity of the tibia. We like to use for such cases of acute deformity correction the arch fix, which is a simplified technique using two arches from the Elizarov frame components and the hinges on the convex side and a distractor, keeping the basic principles of external fixation and deformity correction. At the level of the planned osteotomy site, we insert the two Kirchner wires to mark the osteotomy as guide wires to mark our power saw, and then the wedge shape of the bone is was resected after completion of the osteotomy, and then controlled acute correction of the deformity by the fixture was performed until the two arches are parallel to each other, the rods are straight and parallel to the mechanical axis of the tibia, and the complete apposition of the osteotomy surfaces. The postoperative follow-up x-rays showing the rods are parallel to the mechanical axis of the tibia, the arch is parallel to the ankle joint line and perpendicular to the mechanical axis of the tibia. The follow-up clinical photo shows the full weight bearing of the patient and the correction of the deformity. There is residual valgus deformity of the heel due to deficiency of the lateral malleolus. The follow-up after removal of the fixator. Of course, we can see here Taylor tilt due to deficiency of the lateral malleus, which will need proximal fibular osteotomy and distal bone transport of the fibula to build the lateral malleus and correct the Taylor tilt. Finally, please remember the 10 commandments of the deformity correction. Before embarking on deformity correction, please answer the following questions. Is there a deformity? Where is the source of the deformity? Where is the level of the deformity? Plane of the deformity? What is the magnitude of the deformity? Where to do the osteotomy? What type of osteotomy? Closing wedge, opening wedge? Acute versus gradual deformity correction? What is the method of fixation? External or internal? Monolateral fixture or circular fixture? Finally, never operate on the wrong bone. And thank you.